Feelings of rejection or even betrayal. But seduction is a smooth persuasion. And it always happens at the intersection of desire and opportunity. Desire and opportunity. The appeal to what we desire the most, belonging or recognition or status, open to the opportunity to be tempted by that desire and seduced into compromising ourselves or our wallets or our core values or even our relationships. You know, each of us in this consumer-driven society is seduced or tempted every day. We are tempted by false promises 24/7. We are tempted to take on the world's values all the time. And this culture is so good at this tempting and seduction. You know, we are told over and over in media and in cyberspace, we know, we understand you're worth it. You are worth that new shiny thing by owning that kind of car, by this type of wine glass or this particular phone or even white teeth. They suggest that in those things you will discover your identity and move closer to having a meaningful life. This will make you happy. But we know that's ludicrous. I mean, how can having a particular laptop or phone or set of dishes enhance your sense of self-worth? Yet, scholarship and lived experience suggest that we are so starved for a sense of meaning and purpose that we make many of our decisions based on the hope that that false lure tells us, that we will feel less alone, that we will feel less incomplete if we simply buy what they are selling. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with having nice things, but the quest for belonging through merchandising, status alone will lead you not to completeness, but to debt and disappointment. Still unfulfilled. Yes, the world is full of seduction waiting to tempt us. And so I think today's lesson is a good word for the first Sunday of Lent. Because Lent is a time when many of us as a spiritual practice try to be more disciplined in our decisions. An attempt to be loyal to those practices we know will strengthen us. Ah, but temptation is around every corner. And that is part of the theological grounding for this text. You know, the voice of temptation is raised in the first book of the Bible, in the beginning of our sacred text, in the book of Genesis. And now we hear it again here. In both accounts, we see core values being challenged. We see in Genesis that we can be tempted in abundance when everything is going fine. And we see in this text, we can be tempted in the wilderness when we are tired and hungry and thirsty. Temptation is always lurking. And like in our narrative, the voice of seduction is the snake, the devil, the deceiver. It reminds us that the voice of sweet reason often can mean us no good. We know that a voice means us no good, but it moves us away from what the Lord desires: goodness, mercy, forgiveness, good stewardship, and so on. So here in today's text, Jesus shows us how to deal with the ultimate seduction. Now, this is surprising in into doing things that prove how special we are, to prove that we're valued. But sometimes that can move us away from God. That's the core of temptation. How do you know that you're loved by God? Prove it. How do you know that it matters to do the right thing when no one is looking? Prove it. How do you know that your private prayers make a difference? The world says if you are a believer, God should know your heart. You're worth anger at other people's expense. The world says we are not all made in God's image. We need to fear those who don't look like us or worship like us. They might be walking these streets like us. God should know, if you're a child of God, that you are worth protecting. And if you are not careful, if you listen to that voice, you can be seduced into worshiping militarism. The world says God should bless you with your heart's desire. You got your heart. Let them other people figure out how to get theirs. And the world will see with all that you have that you are one of God's special ones. And if you're not careful, you can be seduced into worshiping capitalism. The world says, if the ominous they don't behave the way we do, don't speak the way we do, don't believe the way we do, don't love the way we do, don't speak the language we do, then well, they are just not like us. Just worship other languages. And if you do that, you will be sure of who you are. But if you're not careful, you can be seduced into dominating others to win at all costs, to keep others, the others, in their place. I wonder on this first Sunday, Lent, can we be honest about the temptations that each of us face? The temptation to define ourselves by what we have or what we don't have, and to define ourselves against what we fear or don't understand. I wonder, might it be a part of just being human, is being aware of just how insufficient we are, that we are often just unsure and vulnerable. Lent is a time of examination. And the questions of Lent are, what are we doing? And are we working for things that will not ultimately satisfy us? Are we spending on things that are not life-giving? For our human dilemma is, instead of serving others, it's so easy to serve ourselves. And instead of being motivated by love, we are so often motivated by fear. And instead of seeking wisdom, we so often just seek possessions. And instead of working for peace, we work for security. And here in today's text, we have Jesus trying to find rest in God and being tempted. The devil is, in fact, trying to teach Jesus that God cannot be trusted to meet his needs. That the Holy One really doesn't care, and if Jesus wants to save his life, he better act now. Now, the first temptation is the temptation of immediate gratification. Oh, how our society values immediate gratification. In America, we are an instant world. We want it, and we want it now. We want instant results. And if it's not worth having right now, well, it may not be worth having. Instant gratification. The second temptation is the devil takes Jesus to the highest point of the temple, of the holy place, and tells him, jump down. And then he quotes scripture to falsely convince Jesus that God would protect him if he were to carry out such a jump. Now this is where the saying comes from, even the devil can quote scripture for the devil's purpose. So here we are in God's realm, on top of a sacred place. Jump down. Put yourself at ultimate risk. Nothing will happen to you if you're that special. We are in God's realm. Name it and claim it. Jump down. The laws of nature, the laws of decency, the reality of your existence don't apply to you. Jump down and just see. If you're a child of God, like you said you are. And in the final temptation, the devil takes Jesus to a high mountain and shows him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he promises Jesus, if you just fall down and worship me, you can have all of this. This is the temptation of worldly power. The pages of history and current events have seen many making this unholy alliance with the devil for dominance and power, from ancient emperors to political dictators to corporate giants. I'm sure everyone in here could list the names of those we know who have literally sold their soul to the devil for power and dominance, and those who have been tempted and seduced to follow them. But here's the beauty of this text. Jesus is not seduced by the ways of the world. Jesus knows the ways of the world just make you emptier. Jesus is not tempted by immediate gratification. Indeed, everything has a season, and there are things worth waiting for. Jesus is not even tempted by the articulation of empty God talk, quoting scripture for the devil's own purpose. And Jesus is not tempted by the kingdoms of the world. He knows that the earth is already the Lord's. And the deceiver says, just admit that this world belongs to me, and as a reward for that honest evaluation, I will turn everything over to you, and you can clean it up, and you can straighten it out. Make it like it was when I first encountered it long ago. You know, like, make Jerusalem great again. He says to Jesus, so what do you say about this? In this sly gesture of friendliness. I mean, why be mad at me? But I'm just looking out for you. And Jesus responds, away from me, Satan. For it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve her only. And once more, Jesus fell back on the word of Moses, warning the people of Israel before leaving them that they must carefully avoid all the gods and nations around. All the false gods around them. And here's the thing. We lift up this point in Jesus' journey, but the taunts to prove himself, they don't end here. In the end, there will be another taunt about throwing himself down from a high place. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. Again, the echo is heard. Throw yourself down, for he will command the angels concerning you if you are the Son of God. Do the spectacular, and then we will believe in you. It begins here and even at the end of his life.
confess. Jesus would be under constant pressure to take up the powers of this earth to accomplish his purposes. You know, the people were looking for and yearned for the one who would throw off the yoke of Rome. Even his disciples were looking for that. Like, let us be special too. Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in glory. Which would just raise envy of the other disciples, all of them who were hoping for the same thing. So I just want to ask you, as we are talking about seduction and temptation, is there anything in recounting this ancient history that rises up within yourself to acknowledge the ways that you are tempted in your daily life? Do you see yourselves in any of these temptations set before Jesus? For in many ways, these are universal temptations. They are all temptations to take control of our lives, to set objectives of our own apart from the will of God, to lower our sense of what God wants of us. As we seek self-fulfillment and self-satisfaction rather than really living out our faith. And as the grounding of this text tells us, we don't have to look for temptations. As I suggested from the beginning, they come looking for us. There are temptations at every turn, and even Jesus was not immune to all of this. He was probably more suspect to temptation than any of us. Because Satan has little interest in tempting those who already belong to him. That's a waste of time. The presence of temptation is strongest in those who are named as children of God. Now, this is a very important spiritual lesson here that a colleague of mine taught me. When I would remark, why does it seem when I'm doing the best I can do that virtually all hell breaks loose? Just when I'm trying to do the right thing. And my friend asked me, do you ever watch boxing? And I said, yes. And he said, well, in boxing, a lightweight doesn't fight a heavyweight. Lightweight fights a lightweight, a middleweight fights a middleweight, a heavyweight fights a heavyweight. So, for the greater good you're doing, if you're doing lightweight stuff, your opposition is going to be lightweight. But if you're doing something profound and heavy, your opposition is going to be that heavy. Remember the lesson in school? For every action, what? There is an opposite and equal reaction. So don't be surprised. When your power for good increases, know that the opposition will be just as strong. That's the truth. So you're not doing something wrong when you feel this pressure pulling you the other way, this opposition. That's letting you know you're on the right track. Look at Jesus. At the height of his spiritual power, that's when it comes. And it doesn't come with some little weak stuff. It comes, you can dominate the world. You can have anything you want. And so it is for us. When your power for good increases, know that your opposition will be just as strong. But here's the blessing. For us, if you stay true to the will of God, the victory is already won. That's what those songs are about. The victory's already won. Not that you won't be tempted, not that you won't be pressed, but the victory is already won because we can trust God to take care of us, not to keep us from hard times, but to give us the strength to get through them. We can trust God not to keep us from being that's why we pray, lead us not into temptation. That's why we pray, deliver us from evil, so that we can bear the truth, so that we can get in sync with the intention that God has for our lives. No longer working for that which does not satisfy. Engaging in a new productivity that heals and transforms. As Walter Brueggemann says, this season of Lent could be for any one of us a return to our true self after almost being talked out of it. I really like that. Let us pray. During this season of Lent, may we stop thinking that the presence of evil has the final word. May we stop and may we start again. May we stop our strivings marked by greed and anxiety. And may we start the work of trusting who and whose we are. May we start the work of compassion, justice, and generosity.